Decided to start off with a lightly digestible topic, which is just the importance of outcomes. And to a large extent, this part kind of sets the stage as to why neck care exists, why neck care decided to further evaluate the positioning of this type of a product. And hopefully by the end of this webinar, we can have a discussion on whether we agree that this type of technology and this type of objective outcome measures are important for the future of physical therapy and are important for the overall care of our patients. So when we dive into the importance of outcomes, I think it's important to ask ourselves the question, what is going on in the field and what is changing? What are the mega trends that are affecting patient care as we know it today? And there we're obviously very quickly confronted with the fact that our patients are aging, or the population in general is aging, but they're staying more active. That being said, they do require more healthcare. And this analysis is basically applicable to the larger scene of healthcare. Because of the aging population, we're also seeing a growing patient population, because older people typically have a more broad spectrum of indications which they're suffering. So with that, there's more pressure on healthcare and healthcare expenditure. So not only is it becoming more difficult to actually attend to those patients and to cope with the volumes, somebody's got to pay for this, and that is becoming a bigger challenge in different countries in the world. One of those aspects we are very familiar with here in Iceland, which shows that there is an increased waiting list for care. I hear numbers from everywhere, since 6 months up to 9 months of waiting list before you can actually get to consult with a physical therapist. So that increased population, the increased indications, and the pressure on healthcare, they're pushing into a direction where we have to find efficiencies. We have to figure out ways to do what we do with a higher level of efficiency so that we can attend to this growing population. At the same time, do it in an efficient manner. So a couple of the tools that are available to address this is newer technology. And from the world I was familiar with before, the prosthetics world, technology has been an important driver to get older people, but in general amputees, active and able to do what they did before their amputation. Health technology assessment is becoming a growing term, a growing practice, which means that we have to assess the technologies that we use. And we need to prove that what we use is the best thing for the patient. Evidence-based is another term that could be used here. We're also seeing a progress from volume-based to value-based healthcare. And in short, that basically means that the payers, the providers of healthcare, are expected to provide healthcare cheaper, but with a higher quality. And obviously, we know that these are things that are tough to go hand in hand. So that is one of the challenges of healthcare for the future. Now, the good news is also that there are improved treatment options, and we will discuss one of those in the next couple seminars and webinars, where potentially we have an opportunity to treat patients in a different manner than we're used to, treat patients and track patients' progress in a different manner, all with the intent of improving their outcome. So this is kind of setting the field, the playing field, and what we know is that the role of the patient and the therapist is changing. Patients, and this is something that is much talked about, the access to internet, they can educate themselves. They are becoming more and more active participants in their care. They contribute to assessment of quality more frequently, and to an extent, they take actual part in the design of their care as well. Whether we as clinicians like that or not, that's just a reality that we have to face. But patients also play an important role as to providing the health systems with feedback on how their treatment is improving their quality of life. And quality of life is this big buzzword that goes hand in hand with healthcare economics, that are the two reasons why payers are concerned with obviously paying for the healthcare and providing the patient with the best possible care. Patients are reporting their own outcomes in many cases. And then another third point, which is very striking, is that in the UK, for instance, people are just invited to complete questionnaires. Whether they have had a hip replacement surgery, knee replacement surgery, the NHS wants to know how this has affected their quality of life and how the care quality has been experienced by the patient. So What we're seeing, which is a really good thing, is that patient-centric care is definitely up front and center. We're seeing the concern of getting more information from the patient to validate and substantiate the treatment that they're receiving. So when we look at outcome measures in healthcare, the definition of the World Health Organization is that basically you're looking at a change in the health of an individual, a group of people, or a population that is attributable to an intervention of serious or interventions. And when you look at physical therapists, that is what we do. We are providing people with a series of interventions. And we're seeing that people are getting, they're required to produce improved quality with reduced costs. And that in itself is a challenge. I mean, we're basically asked to do more for less. And that's typically against the typical way of development of things. So payers are also increasingly requesting and demanding outcome measures as evidence of progress of treatment. And this is something that I have experienced around the world in different markets, that the payers are becoming more and more demanding. They want to see what they're paying for. They want to see the proof that what they're paying for is effectively helping. Let me mute everyone real quick. Magnus, can you maybe try to mute everyone? Because I don't see the option here. So with the demanding part of the service or the payers, we need to make sure that we live up to their expectations as well, because in the end, they're the ones that are holding the future of our healthcare provision into their hands. And we need to make sure that they believe in what they're paying for and that they support those payments going forward. When I look at objectives in other healthcare disciplines, it's very simple. I mean, objectives, the outcome measures all try to do the same thing. They're trying to assess the status of a patient, and then they're trying to objectify the effectiveness of the treatment. And now when we look around us to different types of healthcare, we see that in intensive care, post-surgery, dental care, these are very generally accepted ways of working. When you look, for instance, at the current day situation where people need to be evaluated whether they have COVID or not, we're not guessing based on symptoms, we're actually taking a swab, we're doing the analysis, and we're getting to a strong, firm conclusion. When a person suffers a fracture of the lower limb, which is shown here, after an orthopedic surgery, after reconstruction, there's a validation through imaging to confirm that the surgery was successful. I don't know if any of you have recently gone to the dentist, but the last time I went there, I was in there for 2 minutes. I had a x-ray against my cheek, and it's just standard procedure. People are used to assessing the status of the patient to then objectify or basically define what type of treatment is needed. And yet in physical therapy, we don't always have the tools or the habit of providing that type of objective status. So for most, these types of measurements are considered an integrated part of the treatment and are compensated separately by the payer or by the patient. So this is something we have to keep in mind, because this might require also, if we want to proceed in physical therapy, to provide measurements by tool, that we also have to count on that type of compensation. So swapping over to physical therapy, there are different types of outcome measures, from self-report measures to performance-based measures, which are the most objective ones. Observer-reported measures, basically an independent third party that is observing the patient in their home environment and providing a report on that. And then we have the clinician-reported measurements, which is basically a form of objective observation, but not measurable. So by those means, they're in between brackets. In total, there are at least 152 outcome measures. And the list that you see here is non-exhaustive. There's definitely more measures out there. And it's not with the intent for you to read everyone that is on there, but it just goes to show that there are plenty of outcome measures that relate to physical therapy. And for those of you that would like to consult them, you can always go to physiopedia.com. There you will get the full overview of each and every one of them. What we know from these tests is that some of them take as little as 30 seconds up to a minute to take, if we're just doing a very simple VAS scale, for instance. But many of those actually go over a much larger period of time, all the way up to several hours. So within a physical therapy setup, within the current practice-based type of setup, some of these are just challenging. And yet, they're very important. So what is the importance for physical therapy? It is for us to be able to establish our baseline, to quantify change. If you can't measure it, sometimes it's difficult to improve. If you can't objectify it or visualize it, the patient might have a challenge of identifying what he needs to or she needs to focus on. You can compare, and then in the end, an objective treatment effectiveness is obviously very important as well. So what we try to gain out of this is that we can get a more direct management of individualized patient care. Even though one patient might have the same indication as the other patient, there might be other factors that are contributing to a more complex situation or a more straightforward situation for certain patients. So we have to keep that in mind in our anamnesis. We have to keep it in mind, preferably when we objectively establish the situation of that patient. Then an opportunity to collectively compare care. And obviously, I know that all of you have years of experience in comparing what you feel with your hands, what you're establishing as values and objective measures for your patient. But if we could establish that on a global level, if we could establish that amongst all physical therapists, the data could really help us strengthen our position to then identify the individualized patient care. Comparing between different patient populations, between patients, could be of great value going forward. And obviously, a way to determine effectiveness of treatment as well. I know that amongst physical therapists, we're consulting each other on a regular basis, trying to figure out whether this patient, which you're struggling with, which you're seeing less progress with than you would expect, trying to find out how we can progressively help them forward. Well, in this case, if you can measure it, you have that strengthened base of comparison to support that progressive comparison. And then obviously justifying the treatment pathway and potential continuum of treatment. And I think this is a really important point that we should not underestimate. When I look at the environment of physical therapy here in Iceland, where currently, I mean, the negotiations, you guys know more about that than I do, negotiations with Ministry of Health, where there's significant scrutiny on the position, where they're trying to cut back your budgets to treat your patients, that in some cases, we will need to objectively show that this is the progress this patient has made, this is where we expect the patient to go, and this is why we need the continuum of treatment for this patient, so that you cannot be cut off midway through treatment. And I think these are important measures to have to establish whether a situation is very severe at the start of the treatment can definitely lead to decision-making on justifying certain pathways as well. So I think we should look at it as a tool to identify and to demonstrate the effectiveness of our treatment. And with that, maybe today, but definitely in the future, be able to justify that our next steps in treatment should be allowed and therefore should also be compensated. And then there's an aspect of motivation for the patient, which I think is one that we can't underestimate. People today, they live by data. Everybody has their own Fitbit. They're all measuring how fast they run, how far they bike, everything they're doing. So if we can motivate people by numbers, if we can give them a feedback tool that tells them, where am I today? Where are we going? How am I doing compared to my fellow patients that have the same problem, the same indication? And how can I contribute to this? For instance, by continuing the care while I'm at home in between therapy sessions with the physical therapist. So there are ways to utilize data in a motivational way to get patients to be more compliant to the treatment that we have in store for them. And in the end, it's a win-win situation. Now, I know that to an extent, this all sounds really great in theory, but I also know that there are limitations when it comes to collecting outcomes within the practical day-to-day situation. So it is time consuming. Like I said, some of them take an hour or even longer. Many of them are paper-based, and as we know, the paper trail is not one that is easy to keep track of. It's very difficult to compare historic numbers with new numbers. They're difficult to standardize. If you consider how difficult it is sometimes to perform clinical trials within a university academic environment, or for instance, like at Össur, where we were trying to do clinical trials, just to get patients to be measured at the right intervals is very difficult. So within a regular day-to-day physical therapy practice, we understand that that's a big challenge. So whatever tool we use, however we do it, it needs to be simple and it needs to allow for standardization. There's little automation, right? If it's all paper-based, then you have to spend your evenings typing in the results into your Excel sheets and trying to draw some graphs from it or some visualization that you can then keep in your records for future consulting. That obviously, that time that goes into that is not spent very wisely. So anything that can automate the process is obviously of help. A lot of these tests require space to execute, and that's obviously different between the different practices, but not all these tests are easily executed within the typical physical therapy practice. So being able to do these on different locations or actually monitor over time the patient in its own, in their own environment would be a benefit as well. We also know that when we measure a patient, we're doing a point-in-time measurement. We're measuring him or her today, and like you and I, we all have our great days and we all have our lesser days. So if we're measuring them on a bad day, we're going to get bad results and they're not going to necessarily support. So if we can track them and monitor them more regularly over time, it's very likely that we'll get more reliable data, more consistent data. In many cases, the tests are not compensated for. So it's something that you do on top of your treatment, especially if you then have to do the post-processing of the data. These are all additional requirements or additional work that you'll have to do, which you're not going to get compensated for. And then there's a question about the tools. And this morning, I just came across this video on LinkedIn, where a lady is explaining how in her telemedicine healthcare setup, as a physical therapist, she is using the goniometer to measure the angles of the wrist on screen. Now, towards accuracy, towards reliability, obviously, we can ask ourselves a lot of questions there. The bottom line is that it's not the best accurate way to measure outcomes or to measure anything in particular. So I think the list of challenges is definitely non-exhaustive. There's more challenges that come along with it, but it just goes to show that whatever we want to collect in the future, however we want to collect data concerning our patients, concerning their activity, concerning their mobility, we're going to have to do it in a manner that is very patient-friendly, very user-friendly, and deals with most of the challenges that we see here on the screen. Now, when we take a look at modern-day outcome measures, technology is advancing, and we're seeing some very interesting developments in different fields, most of which are intended to at first assess and report back either to the prescriber, to the treating physician or the patient, report back to the stakeholders in general. And what you're seeing here is a blood sugar measurement device that basically tracks the patient continuously throughout the day and allows for the patient to receive alerts and triggers at the point where they need to take action to compensate for potential drops in their blood sugar. This is definitely strongly connected to their treatment pathway. The treatment pathway is determined by it and is started based on the original assessment. So you're going from assessing to treating to monitoring, because now you're basically able to monitor this patient in their home environment, not in a one moment in time situation, but in their home environment. How are they performing? Are they doing well? Are they doing what they need to do to sustain the treatment that the treating physician has prescribed for them? And then obviously treatment adjustments and the bottom right picture that you see there, I mean, there's automated reporting capabilities that are very in-depth that basically show the physician how is the patient progressing over the course of a day, over the course of a week, how do I need to adjust my treatment to better match the needs of my patients. And those adjustments can be made remote, or they can be made at the next consult when the patient is there. And then obviously this is a loop system. I mean, you go back to reassessing, re-reporting, adjusting the treatment, monitoring, and this becomes the way people are treated. Not necessarily having to make the transfer to the hospital, the transfer to the clinician, the transfer to the physician, but being able to interact in a multidisciplinary way through the technology that is made available. Now, I think that for physical therapy, we have to be realistic. This is not where we're at today, but there is a vision for the future that some of these technologies will become available for physical therapy. And I think NeckCare has done a great job to identify this for one of the more complicated joints of the body, the cervical spine, to try to identify ways to measure more objectively, to follow and track a patient in their home environment, and to feed that back to the treating physician or to the physical therapist. So what do we want to get out of data collection? We have the clear goal of establishing an objective baseline, a baseline that allows us to compare to a database of normal or comparable cases. Let's say I say normal cases for those that are asymptomatic, people that are not injured. Comparable cases might be, if we're looking at the general population of whiplash patients, it's great to be able to refer back to an existing population that shows your patient, that shows you how severe is this case within the typical realm of whiplash cases. Determine personalized treatment plan. Based upon that established baseline, we can personalize the treatment plan, increase the effectiveness. Like I said earlier, we can have the patient continue their therapy whilst at home. You can imagine somebody that has an ACL injury, one person's not the other. Some of them are going to be very committed to the recovery, are going to be able to do the exercises at home, are going to want to progress faster. And obviously there's limitations as to how fast you can go. But if they're showing that type of compliance, if they're showing that type of diligence within their treatment plan, obviously we can continue to personalize it, even remote, if that is what the patient would require or request. So increased effectiveness will come from that increased personalization. Objective goal setting and tracking. I personally am someone that really works well. If I get a goal and it's measurable and I can work my way towards it, it helps definitely as a motivator in achieving whether it's a sports activity or whether it is recovery from treatment. So we should definitely use that to help people be motivated to take part in the therapy and treatment and try to get a fast recovery in the case where it's possible. Collecting data as a part of in-clinic treatment, obviously. I mean, doing it while the patient is with you, while the patient is present. Each treatment counts. Every treatment can show progress. Every treatment can give you an update as to how the patient is doing. So we should use it as a part of the treatment, but also whilst the patient is at home. If we, as physical therapists, or when we as physical therapists prescribe exercise for the patients to do at home, I'd say we're probably all in agreement that 99% of the patients, if not all of them, will report back that yes, we did all the exercises just as you prescribed them. We also know that that might not be always the case. We also know that things come up in the personal life that interfere with the home training compliance. So having a tool that reminds them, having a tool that helps them and helps them train is definitely something that I believe will drive that compliance higher. And with better compliance comes better effectiveness as well. And then monitoring your patient's progress between sessions. Let's say that you're in acute care and a patient is only allowed to load the knee or the leg by 10 or 20% of their body weight. In the case where a patient falls or patient has an issue and that load goes up, you would want to know about that when that happens. Patients might pick up the phone and call you, but they're not always going to do that. So in a future vision, we could definitely see the feedback loop such that, you know, the physical therapist will know where the patient is at, potentially getting him or herself in trouble, and will be able to respond to that. If only just to remind them that, hey, you've overloaded yourself, apply RISE, you know, take some rest, put some ice, compression, elevation, just so that we're not going to worsen the situation. These are the types of things that are all going to contribute to the overall efficiency. So how do we see this on a larger scale in the future for physical therapy? Is basically the combination of the in-clinic treatment and the home activity. which in the in-clinic treatment, you have your therapy, you have your exercises, and you have your assessment, which you're going to do on a regular basis, all directly connected to your status of your patient, all directly connected to the progress of your patient. At the same time, now we're going to get more input and more visibility to the activities of daily living, the home exercises that the patient are doing. And I can tell you, we've had many patients at Oster, for instance, that are using an unloader brace for osteoarthritis of the knee. And at first they say, this is wonderful, this is great, the pain drops. And at some point they come back and say, well, I'm feeling a little bit more pain now. And it's only by through questioning that you find out that, well, their activity is increased by 50 to maybe 100%. So these are the types of important things to know, is to connect the feedback from the patient to their true activities. So in the future, we could foresee that patients are going to be monitoring their progress, are going to be monitoring their activities on a daily basis, and it's all going to contribute to the overall information that you're going to collect and the data you're going to collect with regards to your treatment. So bringing that all up into the cloud, computing that data to then feed it back into an assessment that is going to help you as a therapist and help the patient as the end user to get the most out of their treatment. That's the future of physical therapy, just like you would see it for the person trying to manage their own blood sugar levels. Whilst they didn't have that capability before, now they don't have to worry. It takes the burden off their minds, and they're just more in charge of their own therapy and more capable of feeding back information to their therapist in a very objective manner, measurable way. So when we look at the benefits, I've touched upon quite a few of them, but for a patient to visualize their problem, to see in numbers or in a graph what it is that is wrong with them, is definitely something that typically helps them understand the problem. Comparing their progress potentially to a control group is something that definitely helps for them as well to understand, not only to try to beat the average, but also to realize that when there is a period of struggle, you're not alone in this. This is typically how it goes. You set a path for expectations, which then builds a certain understanding of reality around the trajectory of their therapy, which they will be following. And then the motivation to improve, the motivation to be compliant to their treatment, is something that I believe is going to be of great benefit as well. To the physical therapist, it's all about objectively establishing a baseline and comparing to the benchmark outcomes out there, and then being able to personalize the care even further. When we look at the physician, they're going to be interested as well. And speaking to a few physicians here in Iceland, one of the comments I hear a lot is, well, we prescribe physical therapy, but we don't always know how the patient then is doing throughout that process of rehabilitation. So potentially feeding back some of these reports could be of value as well, and to further define the treatment pathway with the physician. And I'm obviously in no way saying that this is not currently done. I'm just saying that we can do it maybe in a more objective manner with objectively collected data. And then last but not least, and I think this is something that we just have to be aware of, is that payers are looking for evidence. Payers are looking at understanding that the treatment they're paying for is value-based, that they're getting their money worth. And I think in the situation which we find ourselves in today in Iceland, where there's a threat to cut 20 to 25% of the budgets allocated to physical therapy, this is kind of a sign that, well, they're clearly asking themselves questions about the value of the profession. And the more objectively we can show them that, no, this is the way we do it, this is the progress of the patients, and this is why the continuum of care is required, this is why physical therapy is absolutely needed for this population, I think that's going to be an important tool for the future to objectify the outcomes and the effectiveness of the profession. So they need the approvals for treatment. They need to be able to do that with confidence as well. And I think objective numbers, typically insurance companies, they don't consist of medical professionals. They typically consist of more statistically and mathematically driven people. So with the objective data, you have something that is more up their alley, right in their ballpark. So in conclusion, objective measures are becoming a standard requirement in healthcare. I've seen it in the United States. There, it's basically gone from anything goes 10 years ago to we're not approving anything unless we see that there's an objective improvement, or we're assessing what the patient needs objectively. I've even seen people being rejected prosthetic legs simply because the practitioner, the prosthetist, is not able to provide the base required information. Healthcare systems are moving towards value-based. And like I said, that's basically, they want to pay less for higher quality, if I dumb it down a lot, but basically what they're looking for is a more efficient way to deal with the growing population, simply because they realize that if it continues to go as it goes today, they're going to run out of money to actually support the healthcare, and the payers are going to become the users, the patients that we have. And that's obviously not the perfect situation for the healthcare in general. Objective measures are compensated for in healthcare. Like I said, an x-ray taken by the dentist, it's paid for by the patient. The blood work measurements, they're paid for as well. So why would we as physical therapists not be able to submit for those types of objective measures and get them paid for, as long as we show that they're an important part of the treatment? Then collecting outcomes in physical therapists, it poses challenges. I'm not going to lie about that. There's some clear limitations to what technology can allow us to do. And the 152 questionnaires that are out there, they all have their pros and their cons. So we need to work on this. We need to make sure that we identify a very good path forward in collecting outcomes in physical therapy. Modern day technology is overcoming obstacles to collect outcomes. And this is the direction that obviously NeckCare is going with modern day sensing technology to collect these types of objective measures that can help improve the assessment, and then also objectify the progress of the treatment as treatment goes on. Outcomes provide value to all stakeholders. And that's to the previous slide. Everybody wins. The physician wins, the payer wins, the patient wins. Everybody has a benefit from being able to look at things more objectively. So it is our belief, and that's on that note, I'm going to end and I'll open up for questions, that physical therapy will benefit from more efficient tools to collect some of these outcomes. And even though NeckCare's starting point is currently the cervical spine, we're envisioning a future in which we can expand the same technology to other types of indications. And maybe we'll put this out there as a reach out to you, to the physical therapy community in Iceland, but we would be very interested in learning with you what are those very important other indications where you feel you need to objectify the outcomes. You need to be able to objectively assess the situation of the patient and where you would like to have an eye on what the patient is doing when not in your therapy, in your care, in sight of the practice, but when they're in their home environment. I think this could be a very interesting thing to discuss further on a forum. I'd be definitely very interested in learning your perspectives and opinions on this. And with that, I think we can unmute everyone. And then I would like to open up for questions.